There haven't been many songs on the extensively deliberated topic of dental floss, but Frank Zappa's Montana off Overnight Sensation is certainly my favorite. You couldn't go wrong to play it for someone who wanted an example of Zappa's compositional style, and it's considered one of his signature songs. Makes sense, as it was performed essentially throughout all of his bands. There's tons of fascinating aspects, but it's the bridge sung by Tina Turner and the Icettes that really floors me. Coming in right after a lengthy guitar solo, its weaving harmony and angular melodic shape combined with a brilliant arrangement sounds like nothing else I've ever heard, all the while singing trademark Zappa lyrics. So what's going on in this recording? Well, in addition to the vocals, the band itself is ridiculous and considered clearly one of Zappa's best. Anchored by a rhythm section of George Duke, Tom Fowler, and Ralph Humphrey, it also featured classic Zappa alums such as Ruth Underwood on percussion, Ian Underwood on woodwinds, Bruce Fowler on trombone, Sal Marquez on trumpet, and Jean-Luc Ponty on violin. Zappa could get some really interesting sounds because of the uniqueness of the instrumentation here. All the tracks on Overnight Sensation were recorded by this group. Side 1 of Apostrophe was recorded at the same studio, but the band was a little bit different by that time. That studio, of course, was Bollock Sound Studios in Inglewood, California, owned by musician and producer Ike Turner. While there, Zappa wanted some backup singers, and the road manager suggested Ike's wife Tina Turner and their backing singers, the Icettes, which Frank didn't know was even a possibility. They rehearsed the bridge for a couple of days, and Tina in particular was so proud after they sang it that she showed it to Ike, although he wasn't as pleased. Zappa explained that Ike wouldn't let him put their names on the album credits, and that no matter how long the sessions went, he couldn't pay them more than $25 per song per girl. Although if you check out the Classic Albums DVD covering Apostrophe and Overnight Sensation, the invoice shows that they were paid $25 per hour. So there are some really neat recording techniques employed here. At a question and answer event, a fan asked about this song specifically.
And I was wondering how you got the tape effects for Montana.
Oh, yours, you mean the ones that are speeded up?
Right.
The way you do that is you take the master tape and you slow it down a minor third and the girls sing on it here. And then when you play it back to normal speed, the track is normal speed and the voices are speeded up. They do it with a device called a VSO, variable speed oscillator.
Did you do that yourself or did someone else do that?
I did it. I even turned the knob on the oscillator myself.
Well, I don't own a VSO, but thankfully modern technology has come a long way since 1973. And with your digital audio workstation of choice, it's possible to slow the song down a minor third. Here's what it sounded like when they actually sung it. Zappa was no stranger to tape speed manipulation, especially on vocals. For example, Gregory Peccary.
Oh, here comes Gregory, little Gregory Peccary.
La 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 la.
Yo, 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 yo.
Or Dirty Love, also off Overnight Sensation.
Whip me up some dragon lotion for your dirty love. Your dirty love.
And of course, it's all over, we're only in it for the money.
Early in the morning, Daddy Dinky went to work, selling lamps and chairs to San Bernardino Squares.
And before the bridge in Montana, he does the same trick but in the opposite direction. He sped up the track and sang normally, so that when it came back to the original speed, his voice was lowered. Here's what that sounds like.
Moving to Montana soon, gonna be a mental toss flight.
As a side note, I first heard Montana on the Strictly Commercial album, which was the single version. Later, after getting Overnight Sensation, it blew my mind to find out that there was this ripping guitar solo before the bridge that I had never heard. Wow, I was missing out. So now that we have some background on the recording, let's look at what's going on here musically. I'm going to draw parallels to a lot of Zappa's music, but there are three pieces in particular that I think are really similar. Uncle Meat, Anchor Roads, and The Black Page. And just as a general overview, there are some obvious qualities that jump out here. Sus harmony, rhythmic motifs, and of course, repeated notes. So let's start off with that harmony. Sus chords are such an essential part to Zappa's music. Ultimate freedom, where we have something built as 1, 2, 5, 1, 4, flat 7, or 1, 4, 5. Now, as far as how they all align with each other, well, I talked in my Alien Orifice video about a way Zappa can shift harmonically, called modal center switching. Essentially, he loves to target precise centers, but can modulate by specific root movements, like half step or minor third, where the new center presents a completely different scale set. Because this interlude doesn't fit into functional harmony, I think it really helps to look for the patterns he likes as far as root movement. For example, moving by minor sixth. The very first harmony change sees a move from F sharp 7 sus to D2. They do share a common tone, being E. He also utilizes this in Uncle Meat, or Inca Roads. It's an interesting center switch to use because, depending on the modes, the notes are usually pretty close to each other with only a couple differences. As we'll see when we look at the melodic material, he really targets common tones that work over multiple harmonies. So while the melody over F sharp 7 sus does not include a third in it, it does come right after a guitar solo over very clear F sharp Dorian. Just for the sake of picking, because it's left ambiguously between Dorian and Mixolydian, let's say the previous tonality continues into this chord, so we can apply F sharp Dorian here. It also really helps that his arrangement for the Zappa in New York shows includes an A in the trombone, and I'm definitely gonna use that just to confirm my belief. Now for the vast majority of sus chords, it's a good bet to say he'll use either Dorian or Lydian. In this case over the D sus 2, we get Lydian. This means the first center switch is between F sharp Dorian and D Lydian, which is really neat because there's only a one note difference. I think he enjoyed the proximity of this movement, really playing with the subtle note difference sometimes. You can see something like that in Alien Orifice, where we see the same change down a whole step, E Dorian to C Lydian. I have to admit, I'm pretty pleased I found four examples going up chromatically. And the same change happens again here and here, up a half step from the first time it happens. Now G sus 2 to E flat sus 2. So to finish out our original 4-bar phrase, this D2 moves up a whole step to E2. This is another important movement like we see in Inca Roads, Alien Orifice, or the black page, either forwards or backwards. And a lot of times he'll actually move entire cycles in whole steps, like in Rapunzel or It Must Be a Camel. So we see both up and down on the same roots, D to E and E to D, although the E has different harmony each time. And keep in mind that E sus 2 is an inversion of F sharp 7 sus, but we'll see melodically that he does not treat them the same. So now in this 16 bar interlude, he's established the first 4-bar cycle. 2 bars of F sharp 7 sus, then a bar of D2 and E2. We see it repeat again, the first 3 bars being the exact same, except he breaks the cycle with the minor third movement, D2 to B2. Minor third is again another very critical center switch, like again in, you guessed it, Inca Roads, the black page, actually, in Montana, prior to the bridge. And like major seconds, he'll move entire cycles in minor thirds, like Alien Orifice. We see it 4 total times here, E flat to C, G to E, and the final 2 bars, which are again, D to B. Now we have our 4-bar cycles established, each made up of root movement like minor 6th, major 2nd, or minor 3rd. And like I mentioned before, once he has created these cycles, it's frequently transposed. We can see the same cycle in bar 9 as we do in bar 5, but up a half step. What's really neat about that is that it isn't the same exact melody, but up a half step as well. So many people, including myself, would probably just put the same melody there, but transpose it. He so cleverly disguises it by breaking the melodic line into something new, so that your ear can't even tell that you're getting the same cycle, but transposed. As we look over this entire harmonic progression, it's important to remember that these chords are static. Sparse harmonies with no third are his blank canvas. When Zappa composes in this style, the role of the harmony isn't to be functional, but essentially to be dysfunctional. What I mean is, we're trained to hear these suspensions as resolving, but he breaks that barrier and really tells your ear, hey, what you're hearing is actually the consonants, not the dissonance. And while it seems like they might not lead anywhere, that's just the beauty of it. I show all these examples because we do know that they can lead somewhere, and he does have specific preferences of where these harmonies can go. But ultimately, this is all dictated by that thing called a melody. So let's listen to that now with the center switching in mind.
Find me a horse.
Man, I still love listening to that. One thing that has always appealed to me about Frank's music is his sense of balance. I think he really knew how to mix complexity with a great melodic sense, and of course, with funny lyrics to usher you in. Even if you don't understand what's going on, it can totally catch your ear. It gives you something to think about and feel. There are some clear, well-defined motifs here. First, rhythmically, a 16th note triplet followed by an eighth here, 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 and here. Each time, the triplet is moving down stepwise diatonically, and the eighth is either down a minor third or up a fourth. The second motif is the dotted 16th 32nd note, followed by either a dotted quarter or eighth. We see it here, 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 and here. Wow, seven times in total. And clearly there's a lot of this that is based on threes. The 16th note triplets, 8th note triplets, quarter note triplets, the sextuplets, and even those dotted 16th, 32nd note groups are all threes as well. That's going to lead to a beautiful rhythmic shift when we hit those fives in the last bar, but we'll talk about that and the three note groups as we get to them. He starts off the very first note on a chord tone, the flat 7 of F sharp E, moving down stepwise to another chord tone, the 5th of F sharp B. We can call this the pluckin motif here, and this one the dental floss motif here. Notice how he lands on the second G sharp instead of a third, really keeping it open in accordance with the sus chords. He carefully leaves out the root and third in this bar, and only puts in the root as the last eighth note in the second bar. There are definitely some intervals he largely favors too, and we'll see throughout, like fourths here and sevenths here. Fourths and fifths are important because he loves very open sounds, and it's very common to see them stacked upon each other. He'll use both minor and major sevenths because large leaps are an important trait in his melodies too. So after this minor 7th from C sharp to B, we see a G sharp minor 7 arpeggiated down, up, up as B, G sharp, D sharp, F sharp. Already we're starting to see some tough intervals. After the 5th up from G sharp to D sharp and a minor 3rd up from D sharp to F sharp, it moves all the way back down a minor 7th to that G sharp again on the very next note. Also take note of this 3 note group of G sharp, D sharp, F sharp. We'll see more groups similar in construction to this later. So on this change to D2, not only is the first note the A, which he so carefully avoided as the minor 3rd of the last chord, but he uses it in the pluck-in motif. This also quickly establishes us as being in Lydian, hitting the sharp 4 and major 3rd of the scale in the same triplet. And he's targeting B again, which was at the end of the first dental floss motif we saw in bar 1. Besides operating as the 13th here, it's important because it's established as a phrase ender, even with the same lyric on B both times, being floss. It's almost like he got to the same destination twice, just with different paths. They're both targeted over different harmonies, because remember, he really loves to play with common tones between two different sets of modal centers. He's really terrific at seeking out which notes fit over multiple harmonies in a specific set of changes. In fact, all of beats 1 and 2 can fit within the F-sharp harmony of the first two bars. It's when we get to this quarter note triplet occupying beats 3 and 4 where he places the root, D, in the melody, a change from the D-sharps we saw previously. And just like I said, he really loves using wide jumps up and down. And we get a good one here. D to the major 7th C sharp down to 6 to E. Large leaps are, of course, a huge staple in Zappa's music, either diatonically or chromatically. And a lot of times in melodies, if you see a huge leap, it's usually followed by going down stepwise in the opposite direction. For example, but you're watching a video on Zappa, so you know you're not getting that. And we get these wide leaps that don't follow the rules. This is also the first of four quarter note triplets, and they all start on beat 3 of the bar. This is the only one with an up-down contour, however, so definitely the widest sound he's going for. You can see how singers, even phenomenal ones like Tina Turner and the Iguettes, could really have trouble with something like this. He keeps the 3 theme going with 8th note triplets, and any semblance of F-sharp minor tonality is totally destroyed with the very first note. A sharp 4 from E to A-sharp, which would be the major 3rd of F-sharp, now operates as a sharp 4 of E2. Talk about taking a risk. Hitting that note really tells the listener that we're moving around now. And just like how he established Lydian with the first 3 notes of the previous bar, he does the same here. The sharp 11 A sharp and the major 3rd of G sharp are here, along with the major 7th D sharp. This is also something very important, an arpeggio of a sus chord. Just like we can see it everywhere harmonically, we can see it everywhere melodically. Here we get D sharp sus 4 arpeggiated downwards, from A sharp, G sharp, D sharp. And in fact, this entire bar is made up of sus chords, and we can see all major seconds and fourths in here. D sharp sus 4 here, C sharp sus 4 here, as C sharp, F sharp, G sharp. And including that last note, we see a stack of fourths, G sharp, D sharp, C sharp. Another example of force would be the opening of Uncle Meat, where we see it arpeggiated downwards over G2 as AEB. And here's another in the black page, also over G2 going down as B-flat FCG. Or over G-flat 2, up down up as C B-flat F E-flat. And in the same bar going up as A-flat D-flat G-flat. It's just such a definitive part of what his sound is, and he can always identify multiple sus arpeggios over any given harmony, and sometimes he even takes cycles in fourths, like To Mercy Duween. Maybe it's a guitar thing. Anyways, that finishes the 4-bar phrase with only these 3 30-second notes in parentheses, which are played by the band but not sung, moving up stepwise diatonically as a pickup into the next bar. The next 2 bars are a complete repeat melodically of the first 2. The cycle is set up and clear now, but there are different lyrics, and he interjects something fun to complement it a bit starting on live performances in 74, and it's not an overnight sensation. Let's check it out.
Oh, I'm riding a small tiny horse. His name is Mighty Little, he's a good horse.
So right here, George Duke plays a certain rhythmic figure on the clavinet called gallops. The original term of gallop in the music sense comes from the galopade, a dance which was named after the running of a horse because the rhythm is so similar. That rhythm is really just an eighth followed by 2/16ths, as you can see all over this gallop by Strauss. That's really entered our musical lexicon to denote horses or really going fast, I guess. For example, in Montana, he uses 2 32nds and a 16th, but the effect is clearly the same. It's a clever imitation, similar to word painting, which digs into Zappa's great arranging skills. This is when the music imitates the action or emotion described by the lyrics, or mirrors the literal words of the songs. So after the words, "I'm riding a small tiny horse," we hear an imitation of the way a horse gallops to really paint a picture in your mind. This technique and example is certainly not used by Only Frank, and these things are all over his music. There's even a couple more examples later in the tune, like after the words, "with my tweezers gleaming in the moonlighty night," and then the percussionist would basically run up the vibraphone in seemingly random fashion to imitate a pseudo sort of moonlight effect. And Zappa even uses the gallop rhythm again after singing "ride him all along the border line."
And ride him all along the border line with a...
The rhythm even makes another appearance elsewhere on Overnight Sensation. He was so good at using stuff like this. The cheesiness really adds to the charm, in my opinion. Some of my favorite examples are Adrian Belew imitating a fly in "The Torture Never Stops."
Flies all green and buzzy.
Evoking a news theme in a song dedicated to Richard Nixon.
You might get a seizure from the evening news.
Or Steve Vai's bomb sound effect in "Dumb All Over."
Oh, read the nice French bomb. to poof them out of existence while leaving their real.
He runs off like 8 in a row in cosmic debris as well, but I won't get into all those right now. So we get that rhythm, but what's happening melodically here? Well, it's 6 notes, and just like how he carefully avoids the third A in the melody, it's the same here. Starting on the same note that the melody starts on, E, it's pretty clearly similar to the phrase in general, going down in steps while getting in that gallop rhythm. George Duke also played this on the Bongo Fury tour, while the Zappa and New York concerts did not feature it. That same band in 77, but with no horns, brought it back, but only played by Terry Bozzio on the drums this time. Starting in 79, Tommy Morris would play the same rhythm, but it was chromatic now instead of diatonic. Notice how it lands on D, a half step above the next note that comes in the melody, C sharp. And this would continue for every tour Frank played Montana on. Starting in 84, it would start on F sharp every time, making it end on G, while Scott Tunis doubled it. And when Napoleon Murphy Brock was in the 84 band and he sang the bridge, Ike Willis would sing along to this part, which I always thought was a pretty amusing touch. Before I digress even more from talking about what's going on melodically, now would be the best time to mention that the 84 arrangement is the only one that's really different. After soloing over this figure, the whole band would continue it into the interlude, with variations as the harmonies change. It's mostly the flat 7 going up to the 1, or 2 chord going down to the 1. I'm not gonna say I love it, but I don't think I hate it. I guess that could apply to my feelings over the 84 band in general. Now that I've spent 5 minutes analyzing a guy imitating a horse, back to that melody, I guess. So the D2 is just about exactly the same until the very last note, which is still E, but up an octave. He really likes displacing notes between octaves, but I think there's something even more clever happening here. As the harmony changes a minor third down to B2, he keeps a chromatic row of notes that crosses bar lines. E, E sharp, F sharp. It's almost like he's playing a trick on your ear, or getting away with something that he's not supposed to by slipping it in there. He also does this in Alien Orifice, or St. Alfonso. He once again establishes Lydian immediately with that sharp 11 of E sharp. This entire sextuplet, 6 notes in the space of 1 beat, includes the sharp 11, 5th, 3rd, and 13th, and we get our first instance of repeated notes here, another essential component of his melodies. Up until this point, the melodic line has been very flowing, using a great combination of leaps and steps. Inserting a phrase with a lot of repetition has to be done carefully, because it can really interrupt that flow. Think about how we talk. Sometimes we can repeat ourselves with two words that mean the same thing in a row, or at least make each other redundant, like necessary requirement, close proximity, or using abbreviations like ATM machine or PIN number. These are called tautologies, and when we use more words than what's necessary, a phrase doesn't become as clear as it could be. The difference is that with Zappa, repetition is completely deliberate in order to create identical melodic and rhythmic motifs. 5 times, he sets up this pattern of one note, then 2 repeated. Here, 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 and here. 3 times, he does the opposite to mess with it a little bit, starting off with 2 repeated. Here, here, and here. These sextuplets include both patterns, which is really neat. He really jumps around so much that any repeated note will feel unexpected. And of course, there are other examples of him using this one note too repeated, like in Manx Needs Women. And 5 bars later, he does the opposite grouping, starting off with 2 repeated. Mogio also has a great example of him changing these repeated sequences. Black Page, though, has tons of similarities here, like this phrase which has the one note two repeated that starts off both of these quintuplets, then a sextuplet just exactly like in Montana where he does opposite groupings, one note, two repeated, and two repeated one note. His ways of using repeated notes always reminded me of Little Hiccups, but they could be sudden yet still so rhythmic. Back to this phrase, like I said, we have one note then two repeated as the sharp 4 up to the 5th. The last 3 notes include the sharp 4 again, plus major 3rd and 13th. The next sextuplet starts with the same pattern. One note, two repeated, but notice it's the opposite from the first sextuplet. Now it's down from the fifth to the sharp four, F sharp to E sharp. The last three notes, of course, being the opposite grouping, two repeated, one note of the third to the sharp four. Now, this quarter note triplet on beat three is C sharp, A sharp, G sharp, 9th, 7th, 13th, but it's formed the exact same way as the last three 16ths of the first sextuplet. If we look at both of these three note groups just from the bottom notes up, then we can see the pattern. The first is D sharp, up a major second to E sharp, and up a minor third to G sharp. And this one is formed the same. From G sharp up, it's a second to A sharp, and then a minor third to C sharp. That's our first pattern. Major second, minor third. The second we'll see is the opposite. Minor third, major second. Now remember that the next four bars are the same as the ones that we've seen, but now up a half step. F sharp up to G, D up to E flat, and B up to C. So we see another three note group as the harmony changes from B2 to G2. Now is F sharp A E, 7th, 9th, 13th again as the last bar, but in a different order. That means it's the same formation-wise from the bottom, major second, then minor third. The contour is changed to go up the minor third first, then down a fourth from A to E. And this measure of B2 is going to be completely transposed, now over G2, with the same lyrics and everything. So now instead of how it started on the sharp 4 of B, E sharp, it starts on the sharp 4 of G, C sharp. And the three note group of C sharp, A sharp, G sharp is now A, F sharp, E, which we also saw in the previous bar. The same three note group, F sharp, A, E with an up down contour first, then A, F sharp, E to end it, down, down. And now moving from G2 to E flat 2, he brings back that same three note group in the up down contour, but transposed to E flat, again as the 7th, D, 9th, F, and 13th, C. And after using that same three note group on E flat 2, he goes down a minor third to C2 and uses another three note group. However, it's formed a little bit different from the up a major second, up a minor third one. Now on C2, he starts on the 7th B, goes up a minor 7th to A, the 13th, and down a minor third to F sharp, the sharp 4. If we move that B up an octave, we can identify the three note group. F sharp up a minor third to A, and then a major second to B. So the opposite grouping of the three note groups that we've seen. And this three note group, quite actually, is found earlier in the tune, the intro in fact. Here it's C sharp up a minor third to E, and then up a major second to F sharp. I don't know about you, but for some reason I can't hear this intro without thinking of this melody. Some dental floss after eating all that candy. And of course, we can look to other Zappa songs to find these groups as well. Looking back through this interlude, we can also see some three-note groups built as major second and major second, major second and minor second, or minor second and major second. But the majority is major second, minor third. And there are spots like here where you can go through and see these three note groups that are either unintentionally made, or if he was trying to make them, are very well hidden. So let's go back and listen through, now knowing what these three note groups are. As we enter the last cycle in these last four bars, we see the only non-minor 6, major 2nd, or minor 3rd center switch, and instead a 5th from C2 to G2, now G Lydian. This melody is clearly similar to the previous bar of G2, starting off with the same three notes, C sharp, D, D. Again, this is obviously similar to the first time we see this figure over B2, all of which start on the sharp 4, go up a step, and repeat. This time it goes up though. E, D, E. This entire sextuplet is just C sharp, D, E, a minor second then a major second. And guess where we've seen that before? B2 is moving down twice from D, C sharp, then C sharp, B, a group of a major second and a minor second, then up back to C sharp, then down twice again, from C sharp, B, then B, A, a group of two major seconds. Beat 3 is where we start to mix it up from all this stepwise movement. We see another three note group, the second major third. This time from the bottom up as E, F sharp, A, but played as F sharp, E, A. And now this is the third time that we've seen this group of three notes over G sus 2. First F sharp, A, E, then A, F sharp, E, now F sharp, E, A. The second group is a sus 2 arpeggio, E sus 2, as E, F sharp, B. Hey, remember that chord? I think we saw it earlier in two different inversions. Beat 4 shows a return to the down-down contour, a repeat of C-sharp B-A from earlier, into the major 2nd minor 3rd 3-note group, B-C-sharp E, but played as B-E-C-sharp. This bar is also important for another reason. There aren't any lyrics here. This gives us a couple things. First, the singer gets a much-needed break from the previous madness they had to endure. And second, it gives the band a chance to show off a really cool line, as sort of a mini interlude that parodies the lines the singer sung. What's interesting is that this is kind of a trick. He didn't intend, at least I think he didn't, to get these results originally. I'll make an assumption and say Zappa wrote the lyrics right before Overnight Sensation, as it was only performed instrumentally up until then. So by adding lyrics to all of it except this bar, you end up with the result of it seeming like the band is imitating the vocal line, essentially tricking the listener. Although it's usually intended, it's a big compositional device for him to have melodic lines that are both sung and played instrumentally within a piece. Has anyone else noticed there's a bunch on Shake Your Booty? Especially like the Rock God post-solo section on City of Tiny Lights. Or the gorgeous Tommy Marr synth madness on Yo Mama. The next bar sees a return to a familiar theme, the same one that starts this interlude, now completely transposed to E7 sus. Notice how well he leads into this, with an enclosure surrounding it as E, C sharp, D. I chose to view the first bar as F sharp Dorian despite the absence of a third, so I'll continue that here, E Dorian. But that means since we're coming from G Lydian, we keep all the same exact notes. This is just him changing the pedal underneath, while all the notes remain the same. Also notice that every time this theme appears, it's the first bar in each cycle. Now in the last 4-bar cycle, it comes in on the 2nd bar. It really tricks you into not knowing the form, even though it's very well defined. He does something similar in Uncle Meat, where he begins a melodic motif on bar 4 of an already established cycle, making it confusing where you are form-wise. It's always something really creative how he plays with those expectations. You can never expect him to follow the rules and present something to you in the clearest way possible. Just like how this theme would always lead into D-sus2, it does so again, but now as a major 2nd from E. We can see some 3-note groups formed again, including the intro group of C-sharp E F sharp, but I think it makes more sense to look at this bar as made up of 3 arpeggios, B sus2, E major, and A sus2. Notice that he's hinting at that next harmony, B sus2, with that first arpeggio. Pretty clever. He goes up from B, C sharp, F sharp, which is 13th, 7th, and 3rd, and goes down from that F sharp to E, which starts the next arpeggio, E, G sharp, B. Remember that G sharp is repeated at the start of the 2nd sextuplet. After the E triad, he runs back down B sus2 the opposite way he started it, now F sharp, C sharp, B. The very last arpeggio in 3 notes is another sus2, A, and it's only instrumental, A, B, E. And in case I haven't stressed it enough, this interlude is very hard to sing. This line in particular almost seems like a tongue twister melodically and lyrically. By no means am I trying to take a shot at Napoleon. He, and everyone else that's saying this, has done a phenomenal job. And there's no shame at all in Tina and the Ikettes recording at a slower tempo and lower key. Okay, this final bar is the real climax of the whole interlude. Remember, this entire time he's relied on things in 3, triplets, sextuplets, or just groups. So just as we've gotten used to that rhythmic feeling, how does he decide to end it? Well,
I'm gonna find me a horse.
Man, what a beautiful shift there. As he pulls our ear into feeling comfortable in all this 3-related madness, he geniusly throws this bar of all quintuplets in. Just another example of how he's so in control rhythmically as a composer. And just at a moment's notice, he stretches it like a rubber band, any which way he wants. Because he built up all those rhythms, it feels like a support that you're totally relying on. And he knows how reliant you are, so he's gotta pull the chair out from under you. Or to use a classic example, it's like he's pulling the football when you think you're gonna kick it. It seems strange that I'm fawning over a bar of just quintuplets, but really, it's so unique in this context. And to hear the subtle difference between these rhythms, I've found that a good exercise is ascending or descending this rhythmic scale. Take your instrument of choice, pick a note, and have at it. Or just use your 2 hands and pat your legs. It's important to make sure they're evenly spaced, and this helps with playing and looking at Zappa's music, obviously. There are so many times he changes the rhythmic value very subtly, so it's nice to practice this. And there are so many classic Zappa melodic sequences that are quintuplets, especially during this period of his compositions. Stuff like Andy, Z Zombie Wolf, Penguin in Bondage, Florentine Pogan, San Bernardino, Echidna's Arf, or Advanced Romance. Staple of his rhythmic language that's produced some wonderful melodies. Now, melodically, besides being one of many that starts on the major seventh of the harmony, it sees some real interesting arpeggiation that runs both narrow and wide. In addition to continuing that major seventh theme, I think that A sharp really highlights the previous A sus2 arpeggio actually. Although it goes by quickly and the A and B aren't directly before it, it's pretty close to a chromatic enclosure and showcases a neat change between these harmonies. Going up a minor third from A sharp to C sharp starts a four note group going down as C sharp, G sharp, F sharp, E sharp. There's a triad hiding in there, C sharp, E sharp, G sharp, or C sharp major. And he loves to throw in the fourth of major chords too, either in the voicing separated as a minor second from the third, or sometimes in the bass. You may also realize that this first quintuplet is altogether an F sharp major 7 with a second in there, and you think I'm an idiot for not just calling it that. Well, you may be right. But the reason I'm sort of discarding that A sharp and looking at it like a two chord arpeggio over the one is that I really think this is closer to his tendencies. First off, because we know a two chord over a one is the easy, obvious Lydian sound, and I think there's just too much evidence of using these triads plus a fourth, voicing wise or melodically. There's a ton in Alien Orifice, and I also showed some other examples in that video. Another would be the opening riff of Cheapness, which uses these four note groups, or triads plus fourths, extensively. And also Zoodalores, which has so many harmonies built on triads plus a fourth, even the C sharp triad with an F sharp in the bass, the same notes he uses on Montana over a B sus2 harmony. And what about the melody of Billy the Mountain, a triad plus a fourth, built the same exact way here, third, fourth, fifth, root. So all of that is why I'm leaning towards a four note group being his thinking here. And if you thought I couldn't draw any more parallels to the Black Page, boy have I got the example for you. I rewrote this bar enharmonically using sharps because he uses flats in the original score, but you can see how similar this is. Both over B2, they use the same exact first five notes. You can really tell how much he likes this sequence and even this specific group of notes. Now after this closed and narrow group, he balances it with a wide one. After the second from D sharp to C sharp, we see a fifth up to G sharp, a fourth up back to C sharp, and then a fourth up from that to F sharp. I think this is C sharp centered again. Doubling of the note helps for sure. Arranging these, we see root, second, fifth, and fourth. This group has both sus2 and sus4, which is really cool. And again, notice the balance between steps and leaps just in these two groups. And that continues through the entire bar, especially since the third quintuplet is the same as the first, but up an octave. It's like he's going back and forth between C sharp with the fourth into a full sus chord back to that first group again. There's this F sharp triad arpeggio that's hidden between groups as well. This last quintuplet is another four note group with one doubled, the first and last note of D sharp. From the bottom, we can see D sharp, G sharp, A sharp, C sharp. Move that D sharp up an octave, and I think this is actually formed the same as the second quintuplet, a full sus2 and sus4 in G sharp. Both of these are formed as major second, minor third, major second. Now we can see this entire bar is just alternating C sharp triad plus a fourth, C sharp sus2 sus4, C sharp triad plus a fourth, G sharp sus2 sus4. And now that that finishes the interlude, what shouldn't go unnoticed is how well this fits in the context of Montana harmonically. This bridge starts on F sharp Dorian, coming straight from the guitar solo over the same tonality, and the last bar is B Lydian, which leads perfectly into the verses, which has a B pedal as well, with a slightly different harmony, but still a great transition. Now I can't end this without highlighting a performance that might not get enough credit. Of course, the great Tom Fowler on bass, who's such an underrated part of this group. And he really anchors that wild melodic line in his bass part. His tone was so punchy with that P bass played with a pick. It's so recognizable. And one thing I've noticed is that the rhythm section is mixed really well during Zappa's solo, especially George Duke's clavinet and Wurlitzer. But when the interlude begins, the keyboards drop in the mix and that bass is so perfectly clear, and it really carries that line on its shoulders. A couple other things I've noticed. Over the D-sus2, he still plays that previous harmony of F-sharp in the bass, but not the root now. A nice choice to blur the line between F-sharp Dorian and D-Lydian as we talked about before. Sometimes it's even fuzzier, like not playing the root of C-sus2 until the last eighth. He and Ralph Humphrey connect really well in these bars too, accenting those upbeats. There's also a lot of arpeggiation of the full sus chords with the major third as well, like here, 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 and here. The last thing is rhythmic. You can see tons of quarter note triplets, a lot of times in rhythmic unison, but other times against other triplets, like here against eighth note triplets, which lines up in a way that accents two notes each. And for every two groups of sextuplets, he plays quarter note triplets. This means there's now four sextuplets for each quarter note triplet, a really neat accent pattern that divides 12 into 4, 4, and 4. He doesn't mess around when we get to the quintuplets in the last bar. Just four quarters to ground that sudden rhythm. What a great line by a tremendous player. Oh, and by the way, during the Roxy shows, he plays the interlude on bass. Doesn't get any cooler than that. And of course I want to mention Steve Vai because wow, this line is hard on guitar. If he was using any shortcuts to play this cleanly, I'd love to know because his articulation is immaculate. His incredible work on tunes like this really makes you rethink what could be done on the guitar. And hey, this composition really makes you rethink what can be done in music. Between his experiments with tape manipulation, showing off harmonic elasticity with modal center switching, or demonstrating his use of repeated notes, three-note groups, or just total command of a unique rhythmic language, I don't think there's anything else like this section anywhere else in music. Simply put, man, this part rules. Thanks for watching. If you like, you can follow me on Instagram at Tyler Bartram. I'm also available for lessons if you're interested. Feel free to share this video and to suggest other Zappa tunes in the comments if you want to see more breakdowns. See you next time.